Welcome. You're listening to Mystic Moon Cafe Radio.
Good afternoon, good evening, just depending on where you are. It's me, Wendy, with Mystic Moon Cafe Radio, and I've got the ever, ever fabulous June, and our techie guy and favorite co-host, Jake.
Hey, everyone.
Howdy.
Yes. How's everyone's week's been?
Hello? Oh, talking to
crickets?
Us?
Crickets? Yeah, us?
That's when you needed the crickets playing.
Yeah, I'll have to get those.
So that good, right?
Woo-hoo, yes.
What about your weather down there in old KC, Kansas City?
Chilly, with a bit of wind chill to it.
Oh.
Yeah, it's not bad. It's not as bad as it has been, but it's not warm.
We're going to be pretty bad.
Yeah, it sounds like next week does not sound good.
Like 12 degrees.
Oh, sorry.
12 degrees here.
Yes, we don't usually get below 30, if that tells you anything.
Yeah. Well, on a really cold day, it might get to 25.
But yeah, we don't... We don't usually get weather that's that cold in the wintertime. So can make sure your you know gas tanks are pretty much full and
yep.
Yeah. All that fun stuff I used to remember in Kansas City. It's like, oh God.
I'm getting a lot of echo on my end.
I'm still not hearing any echo at all.
Okay. And I lost my train of thought.
Weather.
That's okay.
Canada's angry and is sending its frigid temperatures our way.
I think so. We're close to Canada.
That's true. We're a hop and a skip.
Yes, and then we send it all the way down. Mm-hmm. It's like, whoosh, down whoosh. You go. Please leave us. Leave us.
We have a jet stream. Please push east.
Yes, exactly. But we're going to be having our first Advanced Ghost Hunters of Seattle Tacoma meeting on Sunday, so for the year. So that'll be exciting. Going to meet in the Merchants Cafe and the lower level.
Yes.
So that should be fun.
It's part of the underground.
Yes, part of the Seattle underground. So it should be interesting and fun. So I wonder if we'll have to, share the space with anybody eating their lunch. Sorry, people.
Would you like some ectoplasm with those fries? Yes,
exactly. And then Saturday, actually, Ross and I are going to go to a fundraiser event at the Dominion on the Dominion tugboat. It's not on the Dominion tugboat, but it's for the Dominion tugboat.
Okay, got it. So it's in Bremerton?
So, yes. So they're going to have a nice little special. It's supposed to be some old, movies and 1940s band, so it's going to be kind of a USO show with a movie and all that stuff. So,
neat! So, sounds like a lot of fun.
It should be a lot of fun. So that's going to be our fun. And those of you who don't know about the Dominion tugboat, it's a nice little haunted tugboat in Bremerton, Washington, that we got to investigate several times, and a ghost can actually boast and say that we helped save it. One of the stipulations was I can't remember what the stipulation was. But anyway, Ross Allison and David Weatherly put it in their book about haunted ships and lighthouses.
Which I have.
Yes. And they actually kind of saved it and showed that it was, something that people would be really interested in. So...
Nice.
So it's pretty cool. So anyway, we're gonna help with the fundraiser and do that stuff. So very cool stuff.
Very, very cool stuff. I've been busy getting texts and calls about different people wanting dog sitters. So only one place though was ever felt a little off, perhaps haunted. But I think that's in the past now, and so we'll just let that one go.
Well, tell me what you were feeling. Windy. Did you feel the cold, sharp raking of the specter's claws along your back?
There was some unsettled feeling.
Or was that lunch?
And a whole lot of those catch and movement out of the corner of your eye that was not the dog.
Really?
Okay.
Yes.
That's pretty interesting. So you got a little freaked out.
Not terribly, but because, I mean, it wasn't like, you know, things were flying around the room.
That might have been a little clue that something might be going on.
Yeah, that could have been, yes.
Oh, my gosh. Sounds like fun.
It wasn't bad.
As long as the puppy was cute, that's all that matters.
Yes,
he was
exactly.
cute, but he refused to go potty outside while on a leash. So
what?
Yeah. It became real problematic. It was a brand new house for them.
And, oh no.
Yeah, he was pitching a fit.
He was protesting.
He was quite stridently. Mm-hmm.
Oh my.
Mm-hmm.
These poor babies.
Oh.
Let me tell you, I got three dogs, and they're not big. They're not a big fan of, you know, taking their walks in the rain.
Right. Yes.
And guess what? Seattle has a lot of.
Yeah, I'm just like, none of you dogs.
A lot of rain.
You've lived here, you know, long enough. It's not like you're a Southern California puppy dog here.
Mm-hmm. Oh, the little thief! Augie came through and found the bone that I had dropped earlier.
Uh-huh.
And he has now snuck off.
Aw. Mine now. Finders keepers. Oh, God. Mm-hmm. That's awesome. But, so.
Yes.
For our show tonight, we are going to have two amazing, spectacular guests. Let me read a little bit about Todd Bates, and I'll read a little bit of his bio, and then maybe we can bring him on and just kind of go from there.
Absolutely.
But chances are you'll find him in a mysterious abandoned home, walls yellowed by age and doors teetering precariously on their hinges. Maybe a murder occurred, or perhaps a fire. Whatever the case, Todd Bates is on the scene for a singular task, listening for voices of the dead. So let me go through. A lot of you know about EVP. So electronic voice phenomenon, commonly referred to as EVP, are spirit voices captured on a digital or analog recording device, which our group is kind of trying to go back to the analog recording devices a little more too. So we use both, see if we get more on both sides. But the analog recording device that were not heard with the naked ear at the time of their recording. So for Todd, collecting the specialized evidence of paranormal origin is a life calling. After years of personally investigating the mysteries of EVP and studying under a pioneering figure in the field, Sarah Estep, he took his passion to the internet. Now in its 13th year, hauntedvoices.com has quickly grown to be one of the most successful electronic voice phenomenon-based websites on the internet dedicated to research, education, and discussion. The site is also the home to the Haunted Voices Radio. The network of live and archived programs provide audio material 24 hours a day, and Todd acts as program director and its flagship talk show host. Todd has collected some of the most impressive examples of the phenomenon available today and currently teaches his capturing techniques and paranormal investigation protocol via private and on-air lessons. So with that, let's welcome Todd on.
Hey, hi, Todd. How you doing? Hi, Wendy, how you doing?
Hey, oh, Todd.
And June, it's nice to meet you. Jake.
Hi. Nice. Nice to meet you as well, Todd. We're both Illinoisans.
You're an Illinoisan?
Well, I've moved out west, but I am.
Former Illinoisan.
Also, did you hear, Jake, what they legalized here?
Oh, yeah. Let me tell you. Let us know if you need some tips. We've had a little longer.
Yes, that's true. That's true.
Watch out those edibles.
Yes.
They sneak up on you.
Yeah, those gumballs will give you a sucker punch.
Oh, these poor states doing whatever they can to get some cash.
Yep.
Oh, it's great to be here, though. Thank you very much for having me on here. It's been a little while.
Well,
absolutely.
Wonderful having you with us. Absolutely wonderful. One of the why don't we start?
You know how we were talking about gumballs, right?
Yeah. Oh, I wish. I tell you, I think that would probably help this cough that I have right now. Maybe make it worse. I'm not sure. But why don't we start at the very beginning, Todd? And what made you want to get into the paranormal?
Oh, this is crazy. Yeah, that's the million-dollar question. With this, I've been a skeptic for I don't know how long before all of this started. The only thing I believed was true was Star Wars. That's it. Everything else, no ghosts, no aliens, you know. And my skepticism kind of piqued my curiosity in the whole thing. And here locally in Crawford County, there's an investigation team. They're still ongoing, one of the oldest around, the Crawford County, Illinois Ghost Hunter Society. Jason Snyder heads that up. And they had this ad in the paper for a haunted tour. Okay, it's near Halloween. This should be interesting. So get together and go there. And one of our first stops was this old general store. And everybody flew out of their vehicles and cameras are going everywhere. There's flashes and people running and, you know, just trying to get the I don't know what the heck they were doing out there. They were just running crazy, snapping pictures of outside the building. I'm like, it's dark out. Oh, good luck. Mm-hmm. I had no idea what they were doing. Well, I was told that Jason had advised me to bring a recorder. Now, back then, they didn't have digital recorders. I had an old shoebox analog recorder and a sack full of magnetic tapes. And I, being myself, I guess, just split from the group completely, walked back to this old barn that was behind the general store. And I'm in there by myself. It's quiet. And I climb on top of this old log pile, sit down, and hit the record button and just start asking questions. You know, I asked, is there anybody here? Anybody want to talk to me? Thinking I'm in a barn, you know, and that nothing's going to come through. Mm-hmm. And of course, I didn't hear anything with my ear, nothing of that nature. Went ahead with the tour, went to a few cemeteries and, you know, the old paranormal cliche things. I didn't see anything with the naked eye or hear anything with my naked ear. Mm-hmm. Well, I get home and plug the recorder. I used a audio patch cable. Plugged it into the computer, and back then there was a program, it was called Cool Edit. It's Adobe Audition now. So I hit play and run it through there. It just puts the whole thing on the computer and I start listening to it. And of course, you hear myself talking, nothing. You hear crickets in the background. And then out of nowhere on this tape, which I still have in a tote, there's this sound. I hear this pounding on the floor. You know, it's like a poof, poof, poof. And then a horse. It's like a it just blew my mind. Thinking, how in the world? Because it was so clear. I said, how in the world did I hear it on this, but not hear it when I was sitting there? And that just, I became obsessed. I mean, I wanted to know. Why? Not necessarily that was a dead horse, okay? That just completely bypassed my mind. I wanted to know why I heard it there, but not, and it started. And I got on the internet. Back then it was dial-up, so it took a minute. And I started, talking to people. Got into some forums everywhere back then, and you could put this information in there. Some people would respond, some wouldn't. And that's where I connected with Sarah Estep, and she helped me. She's with the AAEVP, and she helped explain why that would happen, how it more than likely imprinted itself magnetically on the tape. And that's why to this day, I still prefer analog right. recording over digital. It just imprints itself. It sticks there like glue. And from then on, it just escalated. She taught me a lot of things. I learned from a lot of people in the community. Back then, it was a really great community. I've been away from it for a while. I haven't really checked it out. But back then, everybody worked together, knew each other, shared evidence. And
wow, that's so impressive.
Yeah, it was pretty united back then.
I wonder what happened with the paradrama to kind of put a little more...
Yes, exactly. The television shows.
Television. Yeah.
Everybody wants to be famous. Everybody wants their own show, their own evidence, their own everything.
Oh, yeah. The arrogance in this community is unbelievable. People need to remember where they came from,
right.
where all this started way back when, back in right. the 50s and earlier. They completely forget about all that, and they think that they have the best capture. This is going to get them the next television show that's going to be canceled in 4 seasons. it's a revolving.
That many.
Yeah.
it's all about the con appearances, people. It's all about the con appearances.
It's sad. It really is, because it was a great community. I'd love to see it that way again. And you know, I fight for it. I'm sure you guys do. The whole unity again. People just need to drop down a few pegs. That's all. Remember what it is, and that there's problems out there. And you got to tackle them, and there's legwork. Mm-hmm. You have to do it.
Well, you know, that's one thing I say quite a bit is, you know, if certain groups are going to this one, let's say this one house, and there's a whole bunch of different groups that investigate this one house, if all these groups came together and compared their evidence of what they have, I mean, that would, you know, give so much credibility to so many different things. If different groups got the same EVP or the same voice or the same something, you know. But it's like, no, this is my evidence. We can't share it. So that's one thing that, you know, I would really like to see happen a little more is groups kind of sharing their evidence with each other and saying, hey, let's get together. Let's do this.
Me too. And that's something that needs to be started. It was attempted a few times and it really didn't catch on. Is a database where all these investigators get together, upload their evidence. It's so simple these days. It's free, it's fast, and you could just share it and try to recreate it. You know, you're in this field, you're trying to debunk everything. You're not going to be so naive to where, ooh, that house is haunted, it looks spooky. Right. You know, there's brand new homes that are completely infested.
Right.
And people just drive by them or just ignore them. It's the whole stigmata of the whole thing. They just kind of forget about it. Get out there. Do the legwork. Talk to people. Don't text them. Talk to them.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
It's nice. Not hard.
No Go way. Face door. To face.
Yeah.
You know.
We went door to door. You know, you go door to door, you knock on that door, you know, you ask somebody if there's anything that they know of, anything that's happened in the area. Hey, well, old John down here down the road, he's got an old shed that he said used to be a schoolhouse. I'm like, what? And I went and talked to this guy, and he was more skeptic than I was. He said, you go down to that schoolhouse and you do whatever you want in there. Just don't get hurt. It's old. Be careful. Mm-hmm. And that's what you do. That's how you find these places. It's not, you don't go to Google, you know, you don't want to go to all these grounds where it's so trampled. And not only are you getting voices from the dead, but you're getting residual energy from people that have been there or, you know, whatever. You don't know what's there, what's happened, if it's even legitimate. So
that's true.
And you got to have fun with it.
Right.
And then the researcher/archaeologist comes into play, and you've got to know everything.
That's a given.
Mm-hmm. Oh, definitely, yeah.
It's a given.
Well, since we were kind of touching a little bit on the shows, the television shows, are there any shows out there that you personally enjoy?
From an entertainment perspective, of course.
Well, well, maybe even not. Some that, I mean, is there one show out there that you, I mean, would say this isn't too bad. This show I could watch, or maybe even on YouTube. If it's not.
Yeah, some of the YouTube channels are pretty good.
And I've watched those, and they are set up very well. But as far as like mainstream, the only show that I did watch and found the most credible, it was a mix of both worlds. There were all kinds of different opinions. It wasn't one sided. Paranormal State.
Oh yeah. And okay.
People cringe when they hear the name Ryan.
Yeah. Well,
I give Ryan credit because let me tell you something with that television programming. I was trapped with that once. And there's a thing, it's called a poetic license.
Mm-hmm.
And these guys go around, oh yeah, we're going to put you on a 5-year contract. We're going to give you whatever amount of money. But if you're out in a place and something doesn't happen, kind of make it happen a little bit.
Right. Uh-huh.
Yeah.
I've been duped with that, and I do. And every one of those shows is just for that. Just like you said, June, mm-hmm. entertainment.
Right. Yeah.
And if you go, do you remember the film White Noise when it first came out?
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Yes.
Oh, yeah.
Okay. I went and saw that in the theater, and this is the God's honest truth. I saw this at the theater here in Robinson, Illinois, and people brought notebooks.
No.
Really?
Oh, my.
There were people taking notes during the film. And
you're like, what are you doing?
Sure.
This is not real. This is not true to life, people. Yeah. it may have some things. Like,
you got to take it with a grain of salt.
Yeah, exactly.
And
a shot of tequila.
Exactly. A grain of salt and some tequila.
Yeah.
With a little lime.
And a little chaser.
Oh, those things where, the programming, it had a good standing as far as raising awareness. What? Okay, it raised awareness. It kind of took it down a couple notches on the taboo meter. People weren't so freaked out by it. But people are literally mocking these programs and going out there and charging this thing like they're a SWAT team.
Mm-hmm.
It's not, it's just not going to work.
Right. Or using their ghost box, their spirit box through the whole freaking investigation.
Bye-bye.
Oh, it's like, come on, people.
The apps they have nowadays. They're great. You have to be in airplane mode, though. That makes no sense at all.
Oh, my gosh. Yeah, we could go on forever.
That's why I'm sitting here talking to you.
Mm-hmm.
You guys are legitimate. And that's, it's sad. It's sad, but yet I can understand the fandom. They're getting into something. They follow it like a soap opera, like I did with WWF back in the day. It happens. But real investigations are not like that. They take hours. They're extremely boring. You guys know how boring they are.
Yeah, yep. We know.
It's slap happy. You start saying things. You start removing clothing. Whatever you have.
I'd like to go on those investigations. Sometimes it does get very warm in some of those places.
Yeah.
Oh yeah, believe me. I remember we've had some new people in our group, and we usually have them, with an investigator for about 3 months before they, can do an investigation. Kind of, not really being watched by anybody or anything like that. But we've had several people say, "Oh my God, this is so boring." oh, this is so boring. I was like, you mean you don't, you're expecting like bricks and, you know, and boards being thrown at your head? It's like, well, it's just so boring. I was like, yeah.
Here, let me accommodate you.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah. Yeah. Here, take these readings. Give them something to do. Get them out mm-hmm. there. You know, get them off that damn folding chair. And you know, do some legwork. Exactly. And they're doing their nails or whatever. It's well, I'm watching the DVR. No, you're not. You're doing your nails.
Yeah.
You just missed the message right there. They just revealed who killed Hoffa. And you're doing your nails.
Wouldn't that be amazing?
You like, get so bored.
Yep.
That's okay. You know, I sometimes, you know, when I'm going through my hours and hours and hours and hours and hours of video and audio, it's like when you get that one creepy little voice that doesn't fit in there, and it, you know, it just it all the hours just kind of melt away, and you're just like, oh my God, and then you're bit. You are bit for life, and you know, honestly, like. Little just girl in a bar. Yeah, yeah. You know, a little girl in a bar at 3 o'clock in the morning that's right in the microphone. It's like, yep, there is no little girl in the bar at 3 o'clock in the morning.
Yeah. What are the odds of that?
Right?
Yeah.
Depending on where you live, right?
Yeah, right. One that wasn't open and working, let's just
okay.
say. That's sad. But what, so what made you kind of want to get into radio?
Okay. So I built a website and I'm a loner nerd. Okay. And I built this thing and created a little database on the website, wrote some articles, things I've learned, experiences, how to self-help things on programs and how to go out and capture them. And I kept getting contacted. Email, it still works, by email to teach, hey, can you show me how to do this? Can you, you know, sure. Didn't charge a dime for these things, these lessons. And there were, then I had to get, Skype had just kind of launched around then. And you're able to have up to four people. So I was using Skype to teach these lessons. And then there was such a demand for them because there really wasn't that much around back then. There really wasn't. It didn't have any of the YouTube stuff or anything. But there was such a demand for them. I said, okay, I got to figure something out on how I can teach multiple people at the same time. So that's when I purchased an audio server. And back, they didn't have any here in the States back then. They were in the UK. I had to get that. And then began broadcasting it. So I would just connect. The other people would connect. I'd teach the lessons. And then there was, I didn't have a chat room. There was a forum. And, of course, those are a little delayed. So they would post their questions or what have you. And then I just worked it up to where I could have people call in. And then, you know, more people showed up. And then it just kind of snowballed into a broadcast.
That's cool.
Where there were guests and people that had experiences. So that's how all of that started. And it's just been going that way off and on due to my troubles and throughout the years.
Wow. Well, why don't you tell us a little bit about Haunted Voices Radio while we're on the subject?
Well, that is going to be returning soon.
Mm-hmm.
Cool. Right now, I'm raising some funding for it. It's one of those things where it's a passion. And I have a tendency to get too obsessed with things like that. Mm-hmm. I mean, I will go nonstop. When that program first came out, I kid you not, I was doing a show 5 days a week.
And wow.
Then I was doing one 7 days. It was one of those things where I became quite addicted to it because there's so much out there, so much information to learn and so many people to talk to. It's never ending. You got to respect this community because it's job security. We're not going to find an answer here.
Yep.
So we're going to keep going and going and going. So My problem is when I get too much, when I overdo myself, when I bite off more than I can chew. Like I had a few networks in the past, sold one, the other one I severed, cut and dry. That's what I have to do personally, and I disappear. I just disappear from the community, period. I'll go in hiding. I mean, I'll have a little personal Facebook or something going, but I won't interact with people. The reason being, it's not because I'm mad at them or don't like them or they're mad at me, which a lot of them are, but it's because if I talk with one person and they say, hey, so-and-so just discovered that, boom, there I am, and I'm not ready for it. So I have to wait until I'm ready for it, because when I start something, I do like to finish it for the most part. So that's why I'm bringing it back. I do. I miss it. I miss the people, the education, the fun. Mm-hmm. So it's one of those things that just needs to be a part of my life. And I just have to take it one little step at a time. I mean, if you guys know me enough to go back, when I do the show, next thing you know, there's 6, 7, 8, 9 shows on. There's boom. Now it's a network. Now it's a station. Now it's, so it that's how it escalates with me, and it's tough. You know, it's a tough community out there. There's a lot of great programming like yours out there for people, you know, to interact with, and it's hard. It's a tough market because you get buried so deep.
So I was just going to say, so what do you think you're going to do with Haunted Voices Radio this time? Are you just going to try to keep it at one time a week or
an entire network later on, or building another empire?
Yes. What are your goals where you won't, you know, all of a sudden let it overwhelm you and consume you, basically?
Well, this time I'm in a much better place. I have a very, very, very supportive family. I've got a beautiful, beautiful woman who is behind my side. Sherry, if you're listening, I love you. She is awesome. Very supportive. I've been used in the past, completely sucked dry. Kind of like had the whip crack behind you. Hey, build this, make this happen, make money doing this. I don't want to make money. I want to just maintain the show, just the show for now. Mm-hmm. And I want to have fun with the show, and maybe down the road, sure, maybe that will come up. I don't know. I don't want to look that far ahead. You guys will visit me.
Yes. No, not so good.
Stick with the one show and the website and domain. The keeper of the website is Dreamhost. A good friend of mine, Chris, holds that domain, so no one can take it, and it sits there. All I have to do is contact him, and boom, he turns it on. So awesome. It's always going to be there. So I want to start with the show, just the show, have some fun with it, get back in the scene, catch up on what I've missed, and then maybe down the road something will come up. Who knows? I'm looking forward to it.
Oh, very cool.
Well, the offer stands. I don't have to say which offer, you know. But
well, Wendy.
Tracy Hicks said, you can do this, Todd.
Oh, I love Tracy. Oh, my goodness. She has been behind. Oh, my goodness. Since the beginning, Tracy's been there. God love her. Yeah.
Awesome.
Yeah, we can all do this. You know, it's fun. And yes, Wendy, I know that offer.
Like Wendy.
Hey.
You offer anything you want, Wendy. We're behind you.
Thank you. I knew that. That's why I love you guys so much.
I'm just, you know, with the whole thing, I'm just really picky. I'm really picky. I have my little quirks. Mm-hmm. I don't know. I like the bells and whistles, making the sound this and creating these commercials and intros. And, you know, I love doing all that stuff.
And you're so good at it.
But I've got a great voice.
Thank you. I've got to calm down. You know, I've got to calm down with that. I got to get in there and just
taking that deep breath and saying, okay, one thing at a time. I don't need to conquer the world today.
Right. Because that's the fear that's always going to be in the back of my head is going too far, too fast.
Yeah.
Because you if you go in fast, you go out fast. So mm-hmm. I took this tip from a longtime friend on, you know, taking things slow. Well, if it doesn't work for me, I'm going to change it. And I don't like that. You know, everybody has their little defects. That's mine. Well, I want to go this fast. No, if you go this fast, I want to go this fast. I can handle it. Are you sure? Sure. And here we are.
Mm-hmm.
So, I mean, that's just a message to anybody out there. Be careful. You can't get obsessed with this. You can get very obsessed with this field because it's in our human nature to find the answer, to figure it out, to solve the puzzle. This one mm-hmm. can't be. No. I just, you know, it's.
That's what makes me so mad when I hear people calling themselves experts in this field. It's like there aren't any experts in the field. There's experienced, lots of experience, but there are no experts in this field. Because nobody's really going to know until they're dead.
No, absolutely. No one's in any rush to get there.
Yeah. And it's going to be like, oh, man.
Yeah. Oops, that's simple. We're going to be up there. Yeah, good. Now it's my turn. So that's the fun thing. Yeah, if you hear the word expert, run. Just run quick.
It's like, get the hell out of here.
No. Bogus.
So I was just wondering, too, you know, I know that you I know that you are called the king of EVPs, basically. Can you tell us about some memorable ones that that you've had that, you know, just kind of blew your socks off?
Oh, goodness. One in particular, and this was back when the video cameras first came out. They were kind of heavy.
Mm-hmm.
This was at the little schoolhouse. Remember where I went door to door?
Oh, right.
And it was a little Quaker schoolhouse in Annapolis that doesn't exist anymore. They had to burn it down. But I went there religiously. At least 4 or 5 times a week. It was close to home. I'd hop in the car, drive out there. And one night it was eerie. It just felt really thick. You know, that electricity in the air, your hair stand up. Well, I'm outside of the schoolhouse pointing the camera inside. And, you know, you still had the little, you could see some little chairs and things in there. It was all beat up, but the energy was in there. Mm-hmm. So I'm pointing in there, just filming. And I didn't hear anything with the naked ear. Didn't see anything with my eye, just filming away. So I go back and I take that video camera, and 30 minutes later, that's how long it took to hook up to the television by then. Hit play, watch the thing. And you're watching, just picture the old window. It's just no glass, old window, and this ball of light. I'm not going to call it an orb. This ball of light came out, and then I heard the words, "Hey," real loud, plain as day. And then a second ball of light came out from the other corner of the lower right pane. And then you hear, "Hey, Daddy." That was on video. And of course, it captured the audio as well. And of course, I still have that on VHS if it still works. But that was the most memorable. The only thing I could think of at that point was it was a residual of maybe a parent picking one of their children up to walk them home or something. But why they left out the window, I don't know. But it's
that's really interesting.
That one came through. That would be probably my most memorable one.
Wow, that's really something. But can you tell us a little bit about the Sally House and your encounter there?
Oh boy. Oh goodness. Oh, that house was hell.
Wendy, she and I, well, when I got back in town, she took me there when I visited a couple years ago now, Wendy?
I think so.
So it was really interesting. Very cool.
I became very obsessed with that home. That's in Atchison, Kansas. Of course, I'm here in Illinois. That's 8 hours away. Mm-hmm. I was so obsessed, and I kid you not when I say this, I would literally get up at 2 a.m., hop in the car, drive to Kansas. I had a key to the house. The owner, Les, at the time, I could come and go, that kind of thing. And I became obsessed with that house. I would go there alone, or I would go there and pick up a couple guys there in town that used to help out. That house, it's evil, in my opinion. It's just...
I know a lot of people do get obsessed with it, to that degree that you were.
That's what it feeds off of.
Mm-hmm.
You know, the story behind it, it's a long story, and we don't have that much time, but it's a long story with little Sally. Mm-hmm. But she's got a fixation with fire. She has a tendency to burn things. During the investigations there, I had... Tony Pickman came in for the first time in years, since he had been off the television show there they were on. Tony wanted to try it out. And of course, I advised him not to, but he came in, and there's a video floating around on YouTube. I think it's called Sally House Attack or something, if you guys wanted to search it, okay. Where he was cut right there, thin air. I was coming out of Sally's room after a session with Mike, the old camera guy with the team. And here comes Tony just out of nowhere with this cut on his arm. Now, this may seem unethical or whatever, but I did search Tony before. I searched him and Deb.
I totally understand that. Yeah.
Just in case.
Mm-hmm.
They were searched. But with this cut, okay, it appeared. And then I see it. You can see a little bit on camera at the beginning. And then I'm taking him down the stairs. And as soon as we get outside, blood just starts spewing out of this wound.
Oh, my gosh.
It's about a 2-inch gash. And it's right there on the video clip. And he refused to go to the hospital because he gets made fun of so much. When he goes in there, they just make fun of him because he's got scars, so many scars all over him, all over the place. Well, after we got the bleeding stopped, Tony was really agitated. You know, he didn't want this thing to win. You know, he wanted peace. He just wanted, because it bothered them at their new home as well.
Mm.
He just wanted peace. So he's begging, you know, Todd, let me go back in there. And Tony, absolutely not. And then, you know, finally I said, okay, you're going to sit in the chair in the dining room and you go no further. He says, okay. So he's sitting there, and we had a couple cameras pointed on him, and we're doing our thing in the kitchen. And then lo and behold, he just, you know, makes this, you hear the chair kind of crack, you know, like a wooden chair when it moves. And he pulls this thing out from underneath him, from his rear end. And it's a remote control. And this remote is on fire. It is melting. It is cracking. It's smoking.
Oh, my.
This remote obviously wasn't on him when he came in. Mm-hmm. And a few years or so, this remote's been missing from their house. They lost it from their new house. And it appeared there. So that was put on the table, of course. It's cracking, and it's just really wicked stuff. But that house, it scratches people, it burns them. But worst of all, these things follow you wherever you go. When I came home, my daughter, my oldest, she was 11 or 12 at the time. And she woke up screaming one night. Ran into the bedroom to come in there with mom and dad because she was terrified. She saw a little girl at the end of her bed, and it shut off her radio because she slept with the radio on. It shut off the radio, and that woke her up, and boom, there she was at the end of the bed, and she described her to a T.
Oh, wow.
Oh, wow. It's just, yeah.
And that gets to the point where, okay, we're calling somebody in here. So it's, you got to be careful with that house. I've learned a lot of things from that home. I can't say there was any good times.
Oh,
I can't, any happy times from
that. Oh, dang.
But you learn a lot from that. It's, like the phantom furniture, the things moving upstairs. It sounds like somebody dropping a huge bowling ball all over the place upstairs. And there's nothing in that, or at the time, there was nothing in that home, no furniture whatsoever. You hear all these weird sounds, and there was some really good EVP. We did get it capture an EVP of what we think is Sally trying to blow out a candle, and you can hear the blowing noise, and then at the end you hear her say, or whoever it was, too hard. That was like a, you know, too hard, like a whisper. So it, but the candle flickered. We never did any seances in there or used a Ouija in there. I did a few things with static electricity and mirrors, things like that in there, a little bit of scrying, nothing massive that was going to stir it up. But that house is pissed. For some reason, it is pissed off, and it lays dormant for a long time, and it'll wake up. And from what I hear, they have a lot of tours going in there. Somebody's going to get hurt.
Even if it just someone shoves them down that staircase.
Right.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. I mean, it's just, but with that, you know, the obsession again just kept me going in there for more, going for more and more. And it was draining. People would notice a change in my personality, just the way I acted, irrational thinking, just crazy stuff like that ever since I started investigating that house. And, you know, to this day, just thinking about some of the things that I saw in there that no one would believe if I told them. But some of the things I saw in there, they were collective. You know, there was more than one of us that saw the little girl standing in the center of the circle looking right at us. You know, it's those things that you take home with you. That's your experience. I can sit here and tell you the whole story, but, you know, it's up to you to believe it or not. You weren't there, but that house has some problems. It really does. It's great for learning, but I recommend somebody experienced going there. No one new or anything like that, because you can get hurt pretty bad.
Right. There are quite a few houses like that, you know, you hear these adventure seekers is what I call them. Mm-hmm. They just want to go to places like that. And you're like, you don't know what you're fooling with. And believe me.
Yeah. I mean, I would go back, you know, if, I don't know, that would take a lot of thought if I would go back into that home or not. I would like to see how it's changed, or the remodeling or doing what they're doing, if that has upset them at all. The most active area, of course, is the kitchen and the basement. There's a nursery up there. It's a little activity in there, but the basement, there's so many stories behind it. Some people think that that's where they put and buried Sally. Other people, we found evidence where she was buried in a segregated cemetery there in town, and it wasn't her own grave. She was put in there with other individuals, because she was half African-American, half white, from what we found at the library. So it's just so many different things, so many different stories and legends with it there. The townspeople, they don't like talking about it because it stirs things up. It feeds it.
So what is one of your favorite places to investigate? Do you have a favorite place?
Well,
to go back to?
I've got a couple. Of course, in the top three, it's going to be that little schoolhouse. Okay. Mm-hmm. That's where I had the interaction with kids. Mm-hmm. Another place that I really love going to, it's in Vincennes, Indiana. It's called the Pantheon Theater. It's an old theater. We did tours there every weekend and investigated there so much. Travis, the guy that bought it, that's where Red Skelton got his start.
Oh, wow.
Back in the day. And it was, it's just a mecca for the activity, because you have so many performers that have gone through there. There's been tragedies back then. There was a fire. There's a segregated section where the African Americans had to sit up, way up at the top. They had to go in through a separate entryway and everything. Mm-hmm. And that place is really tense up there. But I think he, as far as I know, he shut that down due to lack of funding to get it rebuilt. But that was I'd say that's probably my favorite place. The Sally House, I did enjoy it. I became obsessed with it. That being the top three, but not number one.
I understand.
I understand. The little schoolhouse. The little schoolhouse. I think that'd be my favorite.
That's pretty cool. But are you into any other kind of paranormal mm-hmm. things, like the cryptids and UFOs and things like that?
You bet.
I was wondering.
You name it, I'm obsessed with it. UFOs. I've talked to a lot of so many people in the field with that are just so knowledgeable about UFOs, psychic kids. I love those. The Star Indigo kids. The cryptids, mm-hmm. Bigfoot, you name it, Loch Ness, all those things. And I wanted to get more involved with cryptozoology.
Mm-hmm.
UFOs, that's iffy. I mean, I know they're out there. Don't get me wrong. I mean,
right.
they're out there. But to get to some of these places like Area 51 or the closest one here, and this one really woke me up when it comes to researching UFOs. It's called Lucky Point. It's in Monroe City, Indiana. And it's a base. It's an active base. But you go up there, they immediately, these guys come out. They look at your license plate. We're sitting there freaking out. We're going to, Men in Black are here. But you sit there and there's runways. There's all kinds of stuff they have there. And it's out in the middle of nowhere. Mm-hmm. Those places I like to check out. Or
right.
Drive way out in a rural area, which is why I love this area I'm in now. It's very rural. You just look up. Mm-hmm. When I lived in Florida, I saw quite a few sightings down there on the beach, because I would only go to the beach at night. I wouldn't go there during the day. It was just too hot. So I went at night, and you see so many things. Those aren't planes. You just can't explain them. Right. So. Yeah, I mean, I get into all that stuff, astral projection, out-of-body experiences, near-death experiences, all those things, just anything that has to do with the unexplained.
Right.
I love learning about it.
Yep, I understand that. Then you, are you familiar with David Weatherly?
Yeah.
Yes, I was going to say he is our next guest on.
Yes, I am. David's a good guy. Oh, my
God. He really is. Yes.
He's a walking encyclopedia.
Yes. <He's amazing. laughs> That is true. He really is. It's awesome.
Well, you're being further up north there. Look up Dogman. Go up and check out Dogman and like the Beast of Bray Road and all of those fun.
Oh, yeah.
Fun critters. I want a Dogman puppy.
A Dogman puppy.
I've heard of the Beast of Bray Road. Linda mm-hmm. Godfrey wrote a book on that, if I remember.
Several now.
Yes.
Yeah, several now.
She's awesome.
Yep.
I just love her.
Dogman. What's this Dogman about?
It's slightly off from Werewolf.
Werewolf.
Mm-hmm. Right, there, wolf. Yeah.
So it's like a werewolf had sex with a poodle kind of thing.
Possibly. Well, they're kind of associated with guardians of like the Native American Indians, their sacred sites and things like that. And it's just like I say, it's a little bit off to the left of Werewolf, but it's really, really intriguing.
Wow. So do they turn completely into dogs, or are they kind of like where
they're
on
hybrid kind
I,
of
okay. I don't
midpoint.
Believe they're actual wares, because I don't think they turn into people, or I don't think they're people from the get-go.
So okay. Is it like a hellhound kind of thing?
No, it's
similar, yes. Kind of, yeah.
Cerberus returns.
Yeah.
thought in his other heads.
It's kind of like a canid canine hominid. I don't know if that's the
okay. Hominid. No, that makes sense. That makes sense, Jake. Yeah.
big dog runs around on two legs, you know, scaring the crap out of people, basically.
Yeah. As far as we know, not eating anyone, which is kind of a bummer.
Oh, just like looking at people in windows and making people scream. That's about it.
Yeah. Well, I mean, you need something to clean up the roadkill, right?
Exactly. That's probably it.
Yeah. I mean, they're all in Wisconsin and like Michigan and stuff. So you got some deer roadkill, you got some coon roadkill, you know.
Yeah.
Here where I'm at, the roadkill doesn't stay on the road long enough. People, that's supper. They pick
it
up.
Oh, I was going to say, I know Crawford County's like southern Illinois, but I wasn't going to call it southern. Okay.
Yeah, you can. Yeah, that's dinner.
So what about some of your books, Todd? I was going to say, talk about some of your books and how people can get in touch with you or listen to you or whatever they'd like to. Whatever they'd like to do to you. I wasn't going to say that. Sorry.
The book's a work in progress. I'm no author. I'm an audio guy.
I was thinking that you had written a book. Why did I think that? Maybe.
Well, because it's coming.
Maybe I'm just psychic today.
I've got half of the first chapter.
Yeah, psycho. Maybe I'm just psycho today. Yeah.
But I'm hoping, you know, funding permitting, you know, I'm trying to raise what I can to get the show back. You know, as far as some equipment and things like that, I don't have the equipment any longer, unfortunately. So I'm starting from scratch. So if any of your listeners are interested, they can find, you know, the link to that, on my, the Facebook fan page, just facebook.com/hauntedvoices. Just search Haunted Voices on Facebook. You'll see the links there.
And we also dropped three links in our chat, and it's on our webpage.
Thank you so much, Jake. I really appreciate that. And guys, you know, you don't have to donate cash, okay? That's not what it's all about. Just support it. You can scroll all the way down to the bottom. Just click support. It's that simple. Just support it. You know, get some word of mouth going. That we're trying to get this back for the people. It's not something, you know, I'm going to make millions out of here. This is something that, you know, we just want back.
Feeds your soul. Yeah. It's like, it just feeds your soul.
And the website will be around soon. I'll have to do some updates to it and things. So it's going to be a little while. That'll be hauntedvoices.com eventually. Right now it's camped. But if you wanted to contact me, you can do so through Facebook. My general email, it's a catch-all email, first name, last name at gmail.com, toddbates@gmail.com. I'm very humbled. I was the third person to have a Gmail account back in the day.
Wow.
but that email, toddbates@gmail.com, if you wanted to get in touch or have any questions, I'd be happy to help.
That's awesome.
Wonderful.
Well, I'm glad that we could be kind of your stepping stone to getting back into
relaunch.
Everything. Yeah, a little tiny relaunch with us.
I wouldn't want it any other way.
It's awesome.
Definitely.
You guys were fantastic. Thank you so much for everything.
Well, thank you
for being on. Mm-hmm. And keep us updated to the relaunch of the radio station and everything like that, because we'd love to have you back on and talk about your first week or two's programming.
Exactly.
You got it. You got it. Absolutely. Give my best to David, too.
Oh, sure will.
Well, you're welcome. You're welcome to hang out and talk to him. Say hey if you want to.
Well,
it's up to you entirely.
I'm old and I have to go to bed.
Oh, come on.
Yeah, kids are out on the West Coast, so they don't know how late it is.
I understand.
I was going to say, you know, you could have said it's like, yeah, I've been swigging the whiskey in between and...
Yeah, it's starting to take effect. But you guys have been amazing. I love what you do. My goodness, Wendy, I've known you forever. Thank you so much for you know the invitation on here. It was great meeting you, June and Jake. My
Thank
goodness,
you.
I can't wait to talk to you again.
That's
wonderful.
Awesome. All righty then.
Well, have a good night, and thank you so much for coming on.
You're welcome. Happy New Year, guys.
Happy New Year.
Same to you.
Good night.
Night.
Well, that was awesome.
Yes, it was.
And why don't I read about David Weatherly if you guys want to hopefully get him on?
Oh, you probably want me to use the right number, right?
Well, you know. Okay, well, I will read about David Weatherly.
Okay.
He is a Renaissance man of the strange and supernatural. He has traveled the world in pursuit of ghosts, cryptids, UFOs, magic, and more. From the specters of dusty castles to remote haunted islands, from ancient sites to modern mysteries, he has journeyed to the most unusual places on the globe seeking the unknown. David became fascinated with the paranormal at a young age. Ghost stories and accounts of weird creatures and UFOs led him to discover many of his early influences. Writers such as John Keel, Jacques Vallée, Hans Holzer, and others set him on course to spend his life exploring and investigating the unexplained. Throughout his life, he's also delved into shamanic and magical traditions from around the world, spending time with elders from numerous cultures in Europe, the Americas, Africa, and Asia. He has studied with Taoist masters in China, Tibetan lamas, and other mystics from the Far East. He's picked up knowledge from African and Native American tribal elders and sat around fires with shamans from countless other traditions. Is David joining us yet? I'll keep on reading. I'll just keep on reading. Along his path, so throughout his life, he's also delved into shamanic. Oh, I already read that. Sorry, it's my senility.
It's the whiskey,
June. Give me a minute.
It's the whiskey.
I'm sorry. I've got to go a different way to connect with David here.
No worries.
Keep reading. Right. Okay.
I'll keep reading.
Okay.
Well, if you get tired, June, I can read too.
Oh, why don't you go ahead and read, because I need to take a drink.
Oh, okay, perfect. I will go down to this section of it. So, David has investigated and written about a diverse range of topics, including hauntings, cryptozoology, ufology, ancient mysteries, shamanism, magic, and psychic phenomena. In 2012, David founded the independent media and publishing company Leprechaun Productions. He has been a featured speaker at conferences around the world and has lectured for countless paranormal, UFO, and spiritual groups. He is a frequent guest on Coast to Coast AM with George Norrie, Darkness Radio, and other radio programs. David has also appeared on numerous television shows, including Ancient Aliens, Mysteries at the National Parks, and Beyond Belief. David's books include Strange Intruders, Black Eyed Children, the Woodknock series, and the Haunted series, which I have most of those.
Mm-hmm.
And he lives out in Nevada, I believe now.
Yes.
Which could be a good segue, because I wanted to talk about his book, Silver State Monsters, Cryptids and Legends of Nevada.
Ooh.
Mm-hmm. I have like all of his books. They're sitting here on my desk, except nice. For Haunted... Ships and Lighthouses, which is still on my shelf right in front of me. I forgot to pull it off, but I got the others.
Awesome.
Mm-hmm. Well, if we're still working, I can talk about some of his books that he's got here. So,
okay.
The one that I'm most excited about is the continuation of the Haunted series. So you heard me talk about Haunted Ships and Lighthouses, which I'm a big fan growing up on the Great Lakes and stuff like that. Of mm-hmm. these,
and it's a great book. I have to say it. I think it's one of my favorite books, actually.
Yeah. I really like that one a lot. I just mm-hmm. can't get enough of Ships and Lighthouses. I don't know what it is. I mean, considering
me
the interior of the country. Sounds like we've got David on.
Hey, welcome, David.
Hello, how are you?
Oh, really great. How
Hi.
Are you doing?
I'm good.
Well, that's good. Like that evil little laugh there.
I was just starting to wonder about you guys. So,
you're wondering about us? You mean how weird we are? Or...
I thought we were on at 8, so I was about to check with you.
Oh yes, we. I was gonna say yes. It is 8, isn't it?
Yeah, it's 8 Pacific.
Okay. Yeah. Okay, I just want to make sure. I was like, oh,
just
no.
Wait, is Nevada on Pacific time? I always screw this up because Arizona and Idaho
yeah,
are not.
It is.
Okay.
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 Yeah.
Yeah, it's that cutoff line right there.
What's a weird cutoff line with those states?
Yeah. It's very strange. But anyway, welcome, David. We're so glad that you're with us, and thanks for taking time. I know you've been really busy lately.
I'm always busy, but it's
yes.
No problem.
You are. So what have you been doing lately? We'll just kind of do a segue to that. Or anything you can reveal to us, anyway.
Well, traveling. I just got a new book out that is probably going to hit Amazon within the week.
Ooh, what?
Monsters of the Last Frontier. It's Cryptids of Alaska.
Oh, really?
Wow.
This one snuck up on us. I hadn't even heard you were working on it.
Yeah, so that one will be out. I'm just waiting to approve the hard copy proof any day now, and within a couple of days after that, it should be up and available.
Yeah.
It has another beautiful cover by Sam Sheeran, and it follows the format of my other books I've done in the state series, because I've already done one on Nevada and I've done Arizona. So I decided to tackle Alaska after having spent some time up there the last couple of years, and I think it's a good one. There's some pretty cool legends up there.
Okay.
Can you reveal any?
Yeah. Can you tell us? Can you tell us some cryptids that may be in there?
Oh, sure. There's tons of stuff in Alaska, and actually the challenge with this one was kind of
cutting it down,
distilling it down, so it was concise. Also covered everything. For instance, there's an incredible number of Sasquatch sightings in Alaska, in all parts of the state. And a lot of people don't realize that or necessarily think about it, because they think, it's just in the Pacific Northwest or, scattered about other locations. But, the state of Alaska is just such a rich gold mine of these encounters. And then, of course, there are a wide range of other cryptids that are reported up there. Thunderbirds, birds that people report seeing in the skies. As you would suspect, there are a lot of water monsters reputed to be in Alaska, simply because there's, even beyond the snow and ice, there's just so much water in the state, a lot of lakes. One of the most famous, of course, is what's called the Lake Iliamna monster. And stories of this creature go way, way back to First Nations tribes and all the way up into modern times. And there are frequently, each year there are frequent sightings of this creature. Now, Lake Iliamna is pretty fascinating because it's a very, very large body of water, but it's somewhat inaccessible part of the year. And a lot of times people end up going to the lake, they go by a float plane, and they land in, because it is an area that's popular for hunting and fishing and outdoorsmen. So in the midst of that, we get all of these various sightings of this creature in the water that it's a real variety of how people describe it. It seems to be, just my personal opinion, it seems to be that it might be some type of giant fish. It could be a sturgeon, or it could be something along those lines. The show, if you're familiar with the show, River Monsters, Jeremy Wade went up there and investigated Lake Iliamna. And he seemed to sort of come to that conclusion that it was probably a sturgeon or something. But, it's still fascinating. You get all these just different crazy stories about people that have encountered this thing. And there are legends that, you shouldn't go out on the lake in a canoe, you shouldn't do all these different things that come from the early people that lived in the region. So it's a pretty fascinating topic.
It sounds like it. Jake, what were you going to ask about your...
Oh, yeah. So, I was... When you're talking about Thunderbirds and all that stuff, I've read about Thunderbirds. So I've got your books here, Copper State Monsters and Silver State Monsters, and you talk about the giant flying birds quite a bit in both books. And I was just, one of the things I'm always curious about from state to state, I kind of get Nevada and Arizona because it's the desert Southwest, but what are there any big changes in the legends of Thunderbirds from state to state? This is a big shift in geography and regions and cultures, but the big differences between, it could be any real cryptid besides the Thunderbirds, between these regions.
Yeah, so, well, Thunderbirds is actually kind of a good example. First of all, you know, Thunderbirds is one of those topics that in cryptozoology, I say that it's one of these things that's just, it's fascinating, and at the same time, it's kind of annoying, because there are just enough of these sightings that we can't completely dismiss it. You know, there are occasionally these sort of one-off cryptids that pop up, you know, somebody reports seeing one of the, you know, bat squatch, you know, a Sasquatch.
right.
We know bat squatch very well here.
Yes.
There's a few others that, you know, here and there that they sort of, they pop up, there's a sighting or maybe a small handful of sightings, and then they're gone, and there's just nothing else. And sometimes that leaves a very fascinating legacy. A great example of that, one of my favorites, is the Loveland Frogman in Ohio. Mm. But, you know, these are sort of a very isolated thing. But then you get these other creatures, of course, that we have very frequent reports of. A Sasquatch is obviously the best example for that, various water monsters. And then sort of in between is this area where there are a few cryptids that fall in these categories that you say, well, you know, this probably doesn't make a whole lot of logical sense because there aren't a lot of sightings of these. And you would think that there was a gigantic, you know, eagle or a petrosaur or something like that, you know, flying through the skies, then there would be a lot more sightings.
Right.
What happens is that there are just enough of these things that make it sort of nag at people who are interested in these fascinating topics. And with Thunderbirds, what happens is that they seem to sort of crop up, and there'll be a few sightings, and they'll go away for a while, and then somewhere else, you know, in the country or whatnot, they'll crop up again. And the common theme amongst these is that frequently there's a strong tie-in to Native American lore of the region. Now, there are a lot of commonalities when you track various cultural perceptions of some of these creatures, like the Thunderbird. So, you know, the Thunderbird legend, it's in a lot of different places in North America, and it often connects to the regional or the local tribal peoples in the sense that it works into their mythology as a being of a certain type of power. Some of the most common things are, okay, it can control the storms, the beating of its wings sounds like thunder. It can you know, shoot lightning bolts from its eyes sometimes. You know, the flapping of the wings causes the winds and things like this. And then equally, sometimes it's seen as being a very powerful totem. Sometimes it's sort of on the dangerous side. Sometimes it's on the side that, well, maybe somebody can have, you know, Thunderbird power, you know, have that spirit with them, and it'd be a really positive thing. So what's fascinating is that, again, you find the sort of mythology of these creatures all over, and different tribal nations basically talk about them in a very similar way. Now, sometimes we get this sort of blend where they're talking about a creature that they consider an inherent part of their lore and their traditions, but sometimes they'll say, no, this was a physical creature. And that's where it gets very difficult for modern investigators to look at this and say, all right, well, exactly, you know, what are they talking about here? Because a lot of people will just dismiss this and say, no, it's all just folklore, superstition, or whatever. But you really have to listen to the Native elders, and there are ways to ask the proper questions and to start to determine, okay, you know, what exactly are you talking about? You know, you're talking about something that exists in the physical or only in the spiritual, or oftentimes it's both, because the lines are not the same for them as it is for a lot of Western people.
Right.
Mm-hmm. Now, I'd always heard of the Thunderbirds down in more in the southwest of United States, and I want to say Nez Perce were pretty well known for writing about them and that. I didn't realize they were so common, or I'm not going to say common, but you know, they were known throughout the states. Apparently, that's different to me.
Oh, sure, there's various locations around the country. I mean, the most famous story, of course, comes out of Arizona.
Right.
and it's linked to a really interesting cryptozoological mystery. So there is a mystery called the Thunderbird photograph. And the story behind this is that in the 60s or 70s, a photograph purportedly appeared in one of the popular men's magazines at the time. That's the most common assertion, that that's where it appeared. And the photograph depicted a prehistoric creature, essentially, that had been shot down.
It almost looks like a pterodactyl.
Right. It had been shot down by these cowboys, and they had it pinned up on the side of a barn, and they posed for a picture with it.
Yep.
And the fascinating thing about this is that the Thunderbird photograph, and I write about this extensively in the Copper State Monsters book, Thunderbird photograph became sort of connected to a legend that came out of Tombstone, Arizona, that was published in a newspaper of the period in the 1800s that mentioned some cowboys having an encounter with this, you know, flying dinosaur, essentially. So we all know now, in retrospect, of course, that the papers of that period were often very creative with how they reported the news. Different with CNN today, but you know, this whole idea of fake news, I mean, that was the thing back then, because they wanted to be entertaining. So it was, you know, on the one hand, a report about, you know, the value of wheat crops that month, and then the next column is telling you that these cowboys, oh yeah, they shot down a Thunderbird in the sky. So we really have to kind of discern, all right, where are they completely telling the truth? Where are they stretching the truth? Or where are they completely fabricating something? And the lines often blurred very easily between, you know, the various degrees. So usually what would happen is a story like that, it would appear one time, it would get sometimes reprinted in a lot of different papers around the country because they all shared stories, and then it would go away. And that's sort of the case with the initial Thunderbird story. But in later years, it really got tied into this whole lore about these Thunderbirds that purportedly had been seen in Tombstone and in the mountains around Tombstone. And then in later times, we get this whole thing about this Thunderbird photograph. Now, the fascinating thing about that is that so many people, so many cryptozoologists and so many other people distinctly remember seeing this photograph. And I count myself among that number. I can remember and in my memory, it appeared in one of these men's magazines. And for people who don't know what I'm talking about, these aren't really, they're not girly magazines like Playboy. This is a thing that between the 50s and the 70s, there was this amazing glut of these magazines that came out, and they were all geared towards like men's adventure, and that, you know, okay, the titles were like men's adventure, true story. Yeah, they really were sort of a reinvention of the pulps. They were magazine format, and they were very lurid and somewhat risque at times, but they would typically include, you know, some kind of they would try to have some sexual innuendo in some of the stories, and then they would also throw in, you know, like war stories, Western stories, all these different types of things that appealed to the market at the time. And there's no telling how many of these titles were published during that period. The most popular ones sort of evolved and matured a little bit. They became, for instance, Argosy survived for a long time, True Magazine, and Saga. Now, those three are interesting because all three of those, you can look back at old articles in those, and you frequently saw pieces about UFOs, various cryptid creatures, haunted locations. There's a lot of people like John Keel, who's a big influence on me. He wrote for some of these magazines back in the day. Mm-hmm. So they were publishing stories that, you know, were more factual and targeting, you know, they would do fiction stories, but they were trying to target other other sort of subcultures or whatever you want to call it too at the same time. So somewhere in the midst of this, this Thunderbird story, or this Thunderbird picture was reportedly printed in one of these magazines. And I have a very distinct memory of seeing the photograph. John Keel, Ivan Sanderson, and those are very well-known cryptozoologists. They had memories of seeing the photograph. But then it gets even more complicated because there are things like there are people who remember Ivan Sanderson showing this photograph on a Canadian television program. And when people go to trace this down, which I, you know, people have spent a lot of time trying to track this thing down. So when people sort of got that lead and started chasing it down, they went to, someone went to the archives for this show in Canada. It was a very popular television show that was broadcast for quite a number of years. And wouldn't you know, a chunk of episodes is missing out of the archives. And it's right when that episode would have appeared. So the weird thing is we get sort of a Mandela effect going on where people distinctly remember this, but then other people say, no, it didn't. You know,
could have sworn that I've seen that picture. That's really strange. You know, in my head, I actually am picturing this in my head right now. So that's really interesting. I thought for sure I'd seen it.
You know, there's a lot of people, if you go online, of course, it's in ensuing years, it's been recreated.
Oh, okay. And
of course, the modern era of hoaxed photographs. Mm-hmm. We've had people who have, you know, photoshopped, you know, there's one out there with Civil War soldiers with a Thunderbird and all these different things, and it just muddies the waters all the more. But to date, no one has been able to locate the actual magazine or publication and have it in their hands and say, here's that photograph.
How interesting. Well, that is interesting. It makes you wonder, I wonder if I can find that now. That's so funny.
That's a great challenge. Let me know.
Yeah, that would be. Pretty awesome. Oh, my. So let's see. What else was I going to ask? I had a whole series of questions. Oh, well, go ahead,
I can jump in because we're on the subjects of cryptids, but I will eventually shift this to ghosts and the haunted series. But for right now, my big question is, me being a big fan of sea creatures and lake monsters, does Alaska, since this is the upcoming book, do they have anything like a Nessie? I mean, in the Nevada cryptid book, you talked about the Tahoe Tessie. But when it comes to Alaska with all those massive lakes, all that ocean right there, does it have a standout sea monster, sea creature that you haven't really heard about somewhere else before, without giving too much of the book away?
I talked about Lake Iliamna a little bit, and that certainly is Alaska's most famous water monster, I think, simply because there have been so many sightings, and it's been talked about a very long time. There's a few others that are sort of in that range. There's what's called the Kodiak dinosaur, and that can be found in the book too. It's a report from 1969, and there's only a couple of reports about that. The fascinating thing about that is that one, in physical appearance, it seemed to look very similar to how people commonly think Nessie appears. You know, there's this whole idea that Nessie is a prehistoric survivor with this long neck, you know, plesiosaur. And you sort of get this similar thing with the Kodiak dinosaur. And what was fascinating about this is that it was caught on a printout that came from a trawler that was looking for shrimp. And they were running a device called a SIMRAM that gives these readouts of what's below the surface. And they caught this thing. And that was pretty fascinating. They had, you know, the sonar readout that seemed to show some kind of unusual creature. Ivan Sanderson, I keep bringing him up today. Ivan Sanderson was actually involved in that case because he actually went and he talked to the SIMRAD Corporation. He tried to get some solid, you know, commitment from somebody saying what, you know, defining what it was, or trying to discredit it or debunk it, and didn't really happen. So that was kind of fascinating, even though it's a small number of sightings.
Mm-hmm.
It compares to Loch Ness in the sense that, you know, there seems to be some interesting evidence, and the appearance looked the same. Lake Iliamna compares to Loch Ness in the sense that there have been so many sightings in that lake of something. There's definitely something in there, even if it's just some kind of massive fish that we haven't, you know, fully discovered yet or something.
Okay. And then the other thing I would be curious about is, because this is my favorite sea creature, any giant squid, kraken, giant octopus legends up there? I mean, it sounds perfect with all the trawlers and stuff, right?
I love those stories, too. Yeah, I know it does. I love those stories, too, but not really.
Oh, wow.
Not really. You would kind of expect it, but, you know, other than a couple of one-off accounts, there's nothing of that repeats itself up there in terms of that kind of creature. No.
Oh, damn it.
Well, there's plenty of them around, so.
Yeah, that's true. That's true. That's true. I think Baja California is the last report I read about some giant kraken like tearing apart a fishing boat.
Well, you know, I mean, since they discovered, verified the existence of the giant squid, of course, that's, you know, that's a whole new world of things that we can look at now, because I, you know, for me, people are always asking, you know, about these various cryptids and everything, and, you know, why haven't we found more of them, and you know, blah, 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 and I always point to the ocean itself. I mean, there's some people who say that we know more about the surface of the moon than we do the bottom of the ocean.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, they're constantly finding new species as technology develops and we're able to go deeper and deeper into the water, more and more of these unusual and fascinating creatures are discovered, and some of them certainly reflect, you know, old reports that people were describing, you know, sea monsters. Well, you know, the Kraken is a great example, because, you know, for how many decades, you know, people insisted there was no such thing as a giant squid. Well, guess what?
Yeah.
Sure, no.
We found one.
Yeah, exactly. And probably use the same arguments, too. Well, how come we haven't found one? How come we haven't found a dead one? You know?
Yeah,
and then now we have.
That's true. But I'm thinking at the depth that these creatures usually swim at, you know, you're going to have a whale chew them up. Sharks might eat a carcass, you know, stuff like that.
Yeah.
Well, you know, there's a phenomenon in cryptozoology. We have the term globster. And globster essentially is this sort of catchphrase that was created to designate these masses of organic material that are found occasionally washed up on the beach. And they aren't always identified. You know, the various elements, the various things that happen to something that dies in the ocean that's very large size, whether predators or scavengers are picking at it, and then the, you know, the water and everything else that helps create the breakdown of the material, it suddenly washes up on a beach, and it does look like something out of a, you know, a B movie or something. You've got this weird something that's laying there, and you're wondering if it's going to start breathing and you know, snaring people or something,
or just explode.
But these,
yeah, or just explode.
Yeah, right. Yeah, yeah. Which, you know, that could happen too.
But David, I mean, you have led such amazing adventures in your life. I mean, some of the places you've been. What are some places, or just one place that you think is just the most amazing mystical place that you've been to?
Oh, wow!
All
a
around.
Lot of answers for that.
I was gonna say, I bet so.
Yeah. You talk in terms of just like the energy and the level of how intriguing it was. If you mean something like that.
Yeah.
Something that's just taking your breath away when you've gone to it and just like, wow.
Right. You know. So, yeah, again, there's actually a lot of answers to that. Easter Island certainly is going to be near the top there somewhere, just because it is it's amazing in a completely different way. There is, you know, of course, all the Moai all over the island.
Yeah.
But then you've got the other aspects that come into play. It's an incredibly remote island. It's one of the most remote inhabited islands on the planet. There's some dispute about which one is actually the most remote inhabited island. But that's, a lot of people count that as being the one. But at the same time, you know, you've got, here's all this evidence of this ancient culture that, you know, they thought about and viewed the world in such a unique way, in such a different way. And to be out there in one of those remote areas where there are these Moai that you're standing looking up at, you know, and just trying to, you know, just feeling that and trying to put yourself in this position of wondering, you know, what exactly were they doing? What were they creating here? You know, what's this, you know, what's the real power here? Well, you know, what exactly was happening?
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And so, David, we share this in common. I've been to Easter Island. And what I think is really interesting about it is you hear about the savagery with like the 12 different tribes and stuff like that. I think that was the number of it. But I think it's a perfect example of ecocide, because the civilization there didn't last very long. I think it was like 300 years before the Spanish really took it over.
Right.
So all this happened between like 15 something and 18 something. And it's just interesting to see how it all collapsed, mainly because of the environmental situations on the island.
Yeah, and it's interesting too. I mean, I don't, how long did you stay?
About 300 years. They said they could prove.
No, you.
Oh, sorry.
You.
What's that?
How long did you stay?
Wow.
Wow, that's amazing, a great track record.
Yeah. Oh, when did I go and how long did I stay?
Yes.
Oh, I didn't hear
some. How long were you on the island?
Yeah. Oh, I was there for a long weekend. It was about 4 days.
So what was interesting for me was that I stayed about 10 days. And, you know, Easter Island is one of these places that it's on a lot of people's tourist bucket list, right?
Mm-hmm.
And you can only get there by flying out of Santiago, which is a great city. You know, they have these regular flights that go to the island. And, you know, it's a smaller plane, and I'll never forget, you know, when I was going to the island, there's this guy on the plane, and he was the epitome of everything that's bad about American tourism.
Oh, God. Oh. Yeah.
And he was going to Easter Island.
He's standing up, and he's hollering. He's just talking in this really loud voice. You know, he's got, like, a basketball shirt on or something. It's just always, you know, I'm thinking, oh, my gosh, you know, get on the island and get away from this guy. Well, not really.
Because,
you know, the community there is only so big, you know, and there's all these, you know, there's only so many restaurants. And you know, I'm sitting in this restaurant, and this, you know, here comes this guy. You can hear him coming a block away.
Oh,
you know?
God.
He rolls up, and he invites himself to sit down with this couple that was sitting close to me. And, you know, he immediately pulls out his phone, and he's talking about, you know, where he's been, you know, and here's this, here's that, and, you know, here you can look at my 600 pictures I just took, you know. And,
oh, God.
And, you know, he's hollering over at me, you need to move over here, you know, all the Americans over here. And, I just looked at him, and I said, I'm not from America, I'm from Texas. He looked very puzzled and didn't know how to deal with that. And he proceeded to complain about getting the basketball game on a television.
Oh,
now,
my God.
Other than just telling a funny story, the reason I bring this up is because there's this thing that happens on Easter Island, and it's that these planes come over and they drop these people, like this guy and other normal tourists, off for the weekend. And these people get there and they go through this mad rush to see the keys, you know, I've got to see this, I got to take a picture of this and that and this, you know. They're there for a couple of days and they leave. So after, you know, after being there, after this wave of people left, the people working in the restaurants and the various, you know, places where I get, you know, coffee or food or whatever, they're kind of looking at me like, basically like, what are you doing?
Why are you still here?
you came with the other crop of tourists, you know, shouldn't you have left? And, you know, I don't travel like a typical tourist. So, you know, the whole point was I really, you know, for the first day or two, really just kind of stayed in the village and just kind of got my bearings and talked to people and kept doing that the whole time I was there. So then after, you know, people realize, oh, this guy is acting a bit different. You know, he's not worried about seeing the basketball game or doing this or doing that. Yeah. Then they start to open up a little bit more, and you start to connect somewhat with the locals, you know, and they, mm-hmm. they start to question, you know, well, what exactly, you know, why are you staying here so long? There's not that much to see, you know, what is it you're doing? And then you start to hear these other interesting things, you know, so there are a lot of UFO sightings that occur out around Easter Island.
Mm.
Now, that's understandable once you go there and see how clear the skies are and how remote it is. I mean, you're in the middle of the freaking ocean.
Yeah.
You know, in a very different way than even, you know, like Hawaii or something.
Yeah, I mean,
so
I was going to say it's a six-hour flight from Santiago, and then to get to the next island would be like Tahiti, and that's a five-hour flight.
Wow.
That's right, yeah.
Okay.
I had no idea.
But when I went, it was 2010, I think. We rented bicycles and just pedaled everywhere. So it was cool to see everything.
Yeah. And it's a beautiful island. And you know, there's something about the Moai that is sort of it's a quality that's really indescribable. You just kind of have to experience, and you're either going to look at it and say, oh, okay, it's a big stone head or something, or you're going to look at it and you're really going to sort of experience it and say, wow, you know, what is this? I'm convinced that we don't have anywhere near all the answers as to what was really going on within that society and within that time period that those were created.
Now, haven't they gone in with the, I don't know if they excavated one and found that it was actually an entire body that had been buried, or if it was ground penetrating radar that they found that with.
They excavated one. Might have been a Nat Geo project, but there were some archaeologists who excavated and found that it was indeed an entire body
statue.
That was lowered down in the earth, an entire statue.
Yeah.
I wonder if they found anything else, like any answers or any clues or anything like that. That would be something to look into.
Just more questions, I think.
Yeah. Exactly. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah, because it was just on that one hill, I think, where they had the like 30-foot tall Moai. On the other parts of the island, it's pretty much they're just standing on rock platforms.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, because they've carved them out and they put them up on these bases. So sometimes if you look at the pictures, you'll see, you know, some of them are standing in a line, you know, where there's a stone base is built and they're lined up and so forth.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, this is fascinating.
Mm-hmm.
Completely.
But I'm going to switch gears and talk about haunted stuff and ghosts.
The ghosts.
I was just about to.
Though, David, when the new book comes out, I have to rebook you so we can do a special deep dive, because there's not a lot of information about Alaskan cryptids and stuff out there. But on this, I have many questions for you about the Haunted series, because we've got, and I've got them right here, we've got Haunted Ships and Lighthouses, we've got Haunted Toys, we've got, oh geez, I've got my whole list, let me pull out my books here. you got some planned, and that's really the ones I wanted to talk about. There's like Haunted Amusement Parks on the docket, Haunted Sex, Dirty, Dirty. I think there's a haunted underground churches, or something like that to deal with. But So what's the ETA on the next haunted book? Because I'm going to go there because I collect these.
You know who's going to get a lot of grief?
Is it one of your collaborators?
I'm putting June in charge.
Yep. Hopefully that's going to be out soon.
Would it be churches next, or would it be amusement parks? Which one's next?
Yeah, so next up is haunted churches.
Okay.
And I can get a little dig in here and say that my portion of the book has been written for some time. But yeah, I won't go into them too much simply because they're not out there yet for people to purchase.
Yep.
But tentatively, what we've got, and I just spoke to Ross recently, so we're expecting Haunted Churches probably early spring. That's the next one up.
Okay.
And then the next one after that will actually be Haunted Hotels, the Pacific edition of that. And then, we've got the other ones. We've got the other ones lined up. We've got a good core outline and everything of what we're doing. So we've got haunted amusement parks, which is one that I really wanted to do. I think that's kind of fascinating.
Yeah, that's the one.
I'd like to do some investigations.
I'm totally jonesing for that.
Yes, me too.
haunted sex. That's all Ross's fault. And then we've also got haunted underground, which is various underground locations, obviously, that are haunted, which kind of covers a lot. We'd have to narrow it down some, but
I bet
those will be the next ones. And which order they're coming out in, I'm not completely positive. But
okay. For
those who are interested in the series, you can indeed pick up Haunted Toys and Haunted Ships and Lighthouses.
Yes.
I
love the Haunted Ships and Lighthouses
and then
one. I think the best so far.
Yes.
And you just had Haunted Dolls come out, too, not too long ago. Several months ago.
Yeah, the Eerie Companions.
Yes.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I did a book called Eerie Companions, and that was something that I had intended to do for quite some time. And then I put it off for a while because Ross and I did the Haunted Toys book, which has a bunch of dolls in it. But Eerie Companions really dives pretty deep into the whole topic of haunted dolls, not just in terms of like the famous haunted dolls, you know, Robert, Annabelle,
right?
Our friend Mr. Creepy and
yes.
Dolls like that, but it also goes pretty deep into the history of dolls and how they play into various magic and magical traditions, rituals, and sort of why we evolved to this idea of dolls being haunted. And of course I explore some of the various theories as to how dolls can become haunted. And then I even go the last portion of the book, I don't know if any of you guys have read the book or not, but the last portion of it also goes into creepy dolls in the movies and how much that's evolved, you know, sort of hand in hand with this whole rise in the interest of haunted dolls over the years.
Right. Yeah, mm-hmm. Big interest in haunted dolls.
Yeah, I mean, I love a haunted object. That's the whole. That's one of my bags. I love.
David, have you been to that island of haunted dolls or doll
in
island?
Mexico?
Or... Right.
I have
you.
Been there. Yeah.
Yes. Would you go back? Yeah. Okay.
No
so
attachments.
What did you feel when you were there?
Yeah, I'd go back. I'm not afraid of dolls though.
Mm-hmm.
So. You know, I mean, for somebody who has that phobia, I can only imagine.
I think they're creepy, but phobia would be too strong for what I feel about
Yeah.
I was gonna say. So the trick now is that, you know, after it's appeared on several television shows in the ensuing years because, of course, Ghost Adventures did it. Anthony Bourdain went there.
I didn't know that.
And
Destination Truth.
Gates' show, yeah. John Gates, Destination Truth. So, and there's been a few shows that went there. And in the aftermath of that, some of the locals got wise to the idea that they could make a buck off of taking people to the Island of the Dolls, even though they didn't want to go to the Island of the Dolls themselves. So there are at least a couple of phony Islands of the Dolls. Industrious boat operators have been putting together, you know, by throwing dolls all over this, you know, little island somewhere, but it doesn't have the same effect, I'm sure, at all.
Right.
the island of the Dolls itself, the real one, it would certainly be creepy for a lot of people. It is, at the very least, it is an incredibly surreal experience because there are all these dolls that, this dates back pretty far because the gentleman who sort of started the tradition, his name was Don Julian Santana. And this was around 1950 that this guy went to that island. Now, this is a normal sort of, you know, probably middle-class Mexican man with a wife and kids. And sometime, at some point, he just up and leaves. No one knows why. He leaves his family, and he goes to this island. And he starts living on this island as sort of a hermit because no one else on the island. And he goes into the local town and has to take a boat, obviously. The island is deep in the canal systems of Mexico City. And he would show up in town with fruits and things that he'd grown on his island or whatever to trade and to barter for other things he needed. And he started taking dolls as part of what he was trading for. Obviously, people thought, well, this is a little bit odd, but
whatever floats his boat.
Yeah.
probably better not to know. And he started collecting dolls. And then it got so strange because it got to the point where he would be seen digging through the refuse and taking doll pieces that had been discarded. You know, here's a head, you know, here's just an arm, you know, all these different pieces, anything like that he would take. And the story that grew up around this was that a little girl had drowned in the shallows of this island, and her spirit was on the island and sort of taunted him. And the only way he could keep her appeased was by giving her offerings, the primary thing being dolls. So if you can imagine from roughly the 1950s, this guy starts putting dolls everywhere on this island.
Wow.
He's putting them in the trees. He's wiring them up to things. There's, you know, this ramshackle building on the island that he's covered in dolls inside and out. They're propped up on the ground against trees. So what you get when you go there is this very surreal landscape that you're walking through where, oh, here's a tree that's grown around. Obviously, there was a doll there. Now all you see is, you know, an eye and part of the face.
Oh, my God.
Roots, you know.
Oh, my.
Oh, here's a broken doll that's hanging upside down in a tree. Oh, look, there's a big spider living in it that just came out to say hi. This is what you get when you walk across, you know, when you walk over this island. You know, there are all these bizarre sights to see because of how this is. It's sort of, oh, it's almost like a living piece of art or something, I guess, in a way. Obviously, a very bent kind of strange take on it, but this is what he's created. And, you know, it's, yeah, you just can't make this stuff up.
No.
The weird thing, of course, is that at some point, I don't remember the year off the top of my head, but long and short is that Don Julian lived there for a long time, and eventually the townspeople realized, hey, you know, we haven't seen the crazy doll guy come into town lately. Maybe you want to go check on him. And they did. They found him laying face down in the water in the same location where the girl purportedly drowned.
Oh, wow.
Mm-hmm.
So some people think that he haunts the island, that he remained there. The legend is that if you go to the island, that you need to take a toy, preferably a doll, and some candy and some candles, and put it out as an offering.
Mm-hmm.
When you go to the island to help, you know, appease those spirits or whatever. So again, it's a fascinating place. And you talk about, you know, obviously not mystical in the sense we talked about with Easter Island, but that is certainly one of the memorable places.
I'm sure.
Mm-hmm.
Wow. And how do you know if you're getting to the right island? It'd probably be good to speak Spanish.
Just
to communicate a little better.
Well, the problem is, you know, there's a lot of these. Ironically, I've been on a lot of weird islands around the world, and what's kind of consistent is very frequently the locals want nothing to do with the island. You know, they'll look at you like, you want to go to what?
Why?
And, why? So, you know, back when I went there, of course, there was only one, and you know, the guys are all shaking their heads. And like, no. And has this typical, you know, they took me just close enough that I could, you know, jump out in knee-deep water or whatever and wade up the rest of the way and get there. But
just hope they pick you up next day. Then after a little while.
You hope they come back, or you might be, you know.
Oh, God. That'd be awful.
Living on island fruit and talking to the dolls, I guess.
Oh my God, be awful. I'm just thinking about it. I just keep thinking about it and think, you know, you really have to trust that they are going to come back and pick you up. That's really, yeah, that would be hard for me.
Yeah.
I'm afraid.
That's why you don't pay them until they come back and get you and have you back on in the.
Can
village.
You do half and half?
Yeah. Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Well, the trick is you offer more money when they come back. That's, you know, to come back, and you hope that that's enough.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Bring them back. Yeah, you don't pay them round trip up front, that's for sure.
Yeah.
So we're running out of time here. So David, I got a question for you, and this is with your writing process. And how do you go about vetting your ideas for your books? And then the other thing is, how do you choose your collaborators?
Oh, wow. I haven't collaborated with too many people that are in print at this point. Ross and I just kind of hit it off when I went up and did a tour in Seattle. And
well, your writing styles are really close, too. And it's not, you know, jarring at all when read your stories and read his stories. Mm-hmm. Sometimes I have to, you know, wonder, you know, which one of you did this story? And, you know, which is really good. You know, it's just like, oh,
yeah.
You gels really well. Yeah.
Yeah. As you see, I mean, most of the stuff that I produce, most of the stuff comes out is solo of mine. And as far as the process, I really kind of found my mojo, I think, this past year, because I can write pretty steadily now, and I can write pretty quickly at this point. It's funny. I don't know if you guys remember who Philip Coppens was. He was on Ancient Aliens. He wrote a bunch of books about the Templars, various ancient mysteries and things like that. He was a friend of mine, and we had a discussion at one point about the writing process, and Philip had gotten to the point where he could write anywhere. And he, you know, he could just open his laptop and just start writing.
Wow.
And he sort of challenged me to do that. And it took a while for me to really kind of find that groove. But I think I found my voice with it. And, you know, fortunately, people have responded really well. I mean, I've been researching and investigating this stuff since the 70s. So, you know, the filing cabinet of my mind has so much of this stuff in there that, you know, I'm finally am finding a way to get a lot of the material out there. And people are responding. The Eerie Companions has gotten great response from people because of how in-depth it goes.
Yeah.
The State Cryptid series has proven very popular. Mm-hmm. And, yeah, I just keep going. And lots of stuff coming this year, too.
Okay, perfect. Okay.
So exciting.
The reason I had asked is I saw, like, in some cases, Wood Knox. I guess you have anthologies. I wasn't sure if it was, you know, if you selected the partner writers or if, like, a separate editor just assembled it.
Yeah, so Wood Knox was an idea that I came up with back in, 2012, 2014, somewhere in there. And it was just to do a journal is, you know, it's the subtitle is A Journal of Sasquatch Research. And the idea was to give an outlet for pieces that maybe weren't extensive enough for an entire book, but were still interesting to get out there. And, you know, I'm blessed to know a lot of people in the field. And when I came up with the first Wood Knox idea, I just kind of, you know, sat and called a bunch of people one night and said, hey, you know, would you be interested in doing a piece if I did this? And, you know, got an incredible lineup for the first volume. And again, it was something else that people love. You know, the series has done really well. And that's actually volume 4 of that is coming out this spring. It's in editing now.
Okay.
With a bunch of different contributors. And, it's not really so much co-authored. You can pick one of those up and you're going to get, you know, 7 or 8 different styles of writing,
right?
Because it's that journal format, it kind of works in that way.
Okay. And you said that will come out in the spring, so we're thinking April, May.
Yes. For
okay.
Wood Knox, yeah.
Okay.
Hopefully March is what I'm targeting actually for that one.
Oh, okay.
Because it's been finished a little bit, but we've just had, you know, the holidays kind of slowed things down and. The Alaskan book was in line before that, which was,
which is so. ETA about January 15th, you said.
Yeah, around that time.
Okay.
I'll be throwing it up on my Eerie Lights page on Facebook. And of course the website, which is eerielights.com, will have an announcement once it's available. And you can see the cover on there too. It's
is that an otter man?
Cover by Sam Sharon. That is a Kushtaka.
Pushtaka.
A land otter man, which is one of the weirdest cryptids in all.
Awesome. Really awesome.
So we've dropped links to eerielights.com and to your Amazon authors page so everyone can buy there directly as well.
Awesome. I appreciate that.
Yeah. I think the last book that you had published was, and we did get a chance to talk about it, unless we can go over a little bit, Wendy. But we didn't talk. I think the last book you had was Paranormal Files, West Virginia was the last one published.
Oh, yeah?
Mm-hmm.
Yes. That's another anthology, too. And that there's a whole story with how that came about, but I won't go into that. But the book is specifically on hauntings in West Virginia. And there are 3 sections in that book. I did about a third of the book, maybe just over, on specifically on Harpers Ferry, which is a very fascinating town that I spent a lot of time investigating.
I would
back in the
really
90s
like to go
and
there.
At various periods. Yeah. And then Ross did a whole section on haunted colleges in West Virginia. And then we had Dave Spinks, who did a section on Greenbrier County. Just hauntings in the county. And that book's kind of there's a very special thing about that book. When it was originally conceived, I talked about it with a very dear friend of mine who was going to write a big section of the book, and that's Rosemary Ellen Guiling. Rosemary and I were very close and known each other a lot of years. And she had to bail out of doing it because she got so sick. And,
You
know, that was really kind of, that was pretty gut-wrenching. And in the end, we ended up, each of us wrote a tribute to her that's in the back of that book. So the book is, more or less dedicated to her, and is sort of a tribute to her, because she wrote quite a bit about West Virginia over the years. The ghost story book about West Virginia, she did a couple of other things, and she had a whole bunch of cases that she had worked on that she hadn't written about, nobody had seen, and those were going to be in the book, but unfortunately it just didn't happen.
She was amazing.
Yeah, I have quite a few of her books, from The Djinn to Protection from Dark Entities to the Essential Encyclopedia of Ghosts and Spirits. Well, that brings us to tonight's show. David, thank you for being
on. Thank you so much for joining us.
We've got links we've got links to Eerie Lights and his Amazon page. Monsters of the Last Frontier comes out mid-January. The next volume of Wood Knox, March or April, somewhere in there as well. Don't forget to pick up a copy of Paranormal Files West Virginia, his last published book, and you can get to that through Eerie Lights as well as Amazon. Any parting words, Wendy?
Join us next Wednesday when we will be talking with a group of witchy type ladies about the witch's cauldron gathering. They're up in Iowa, and all very, very nice ladies. I'm glad I got to know them. Jerry, if you're still listening, she will be on with us, and it's awesome. Gonna be a fun time.
Oh, fun.
Mm-hmm. We're gonna try spells out on Jake.
Yay!
He's gonna be our guinea pig.
Okay, I'll just have some obsidian ready. I need my protective stones, maybe some onyx. I might be bathing in salt, and I have a big pit bull. Okay.
Put yourself in the salt circle. Yep. Yeah.
Yep. With my pit bull.
David, what would you suggest for him to a good protection, like a circle, perhaps, and.
Might be a good weekend to zip up to Vancouver or something. be away from these people.
Yeah, might be.
Oh, Jerry's talking smack in the chat room, Jake. You better watch out.
Okay, I've got my book on hoodoo. I'll pull out my hoodoo book.
Oh, there you go.
Maybe I can counter, I don't know. June, do you have any parting words that doesn't involve me being skewered by black magic?
The fun of everything, Jake.
No, dude, I'm totally down for it and stuff. It's just I'm not sure how I'm gonna record this.
I just hope everyone has an amazing week, and just keep putting out some positive energy, because there's a lot of crap going on in this world right now. So lots of positiveness. True. And check our ghost.org page out if you get a chance to, and mysticmooncafe.com.
Yes. Yes, A Ghost does have its new members meeting on Sunday at 3:30 in Merchant's Cafe.
That's a regular meeting on Sunday.
Oh, my bad. Well, they can show up anyway.
Yeah, anybody can show up. Come on, dude.
Let's see.
Cheese curds.
Ooh, yeah. Fried. Dill mustard. So tonight's outro music, I have a reinterpretation of a Depeche Mode classic for us.
Ooh, awesome.
So with that, everyone, have a good night.
Good night, everybody.
Good night. Have a good week.
Words like violence break the silence. Come crashing in. Into my little world, painful to me, pierced right through me, can't you understand. Oh, my little girl, all I ever wanted, all I ever needed is here in my arms. Words are very unnecessary. They can only do harm. Spoken to be broken, feelings are intense, words are trivial, pleasures remain.